Let's start learn. Okay, let's start learn. Let's count young principle. 你看那，嗯，Hello, can you help me? Hello? 那我这边有什么？等一下啊。Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Okay. So today we are going to learn these three. This is NetConf Young Fundamental and Practice. And then we'll do the NetConf experiment. And last, we'll learn the telemetry, fundamental, and practice. Okay, let's start learning NetConf Young Principle and Practice. Let's begin. So yesterday, we have learned network automation tools, Python and Parametric and SSH. We have just showed the experiment by SSH. We have another way to configure the device, such as SNMP, this slide, we just focus on the NetConf, the SSH, we just use, just input the CLI, command. So I think it's familiar to us, but for NetConf, we configure the device in another way, and let's learn it. So because the CLI mode has problems such as low efficiency and difficult command understanding, in order to simplify the device configuration and management, NETF set up the NetConf. So then we learn the NetConf structure. Okay. Here, first is some background of why we need the NetConf and the RESTConf. You can see here. And data is a carrier of information that can be obtained from a running device is classified into two types. Here we must stress here, configure data and status data. It means all the data in our device have two database, configuration database and status database. For the configuration data is writable. Such as the IP address of an interface, and the status data is read only non-configuration data in a system. For example, status information and statistic information, such as CPU usage. Status data. There are multiple methods to modify device data. Either based on command lines or based on specific protocol. The CRI and the SNMP are the most typical methods for obtaining device data. Let's see how to configure a network device. You can configure and manage a device in multiple ways. Here we can see we can use the console interface, use CRI. From console interface, or we can use Telnet or SSH. We can also use SNMP set. I think we seldom use SNMP. Okay, with the increase of network skill and complexity, the preceding two methods can satisfy the configuration management requirements to resolve this problem. NetConf based on XML is introduced. This is a device. This is a client. This is a client. The device the device act the server act the server. So no matter netconf or rest conf, the config data is transmitted in XML format, in XML format. For the netconf, we must have a client. For the restconf, restconf, we can open a website, open a website, web application, web application. Let's see some advantage and disadvantage of traditional configuration methods. We see here is the CLI. The advantage is it uses text interface, which is easy to understand for people, for the engineer. Based on Telnet or SSH, easy to use. But the disadvantage here, we can see vendors have different definitions, and the carriers need to learn and develop scripts for each vendor. And CLI scripts are difficult to maintain, and automatic parsing is difficult to implement. Because you may remember about different command line. For SMP, it uses an interface between machine, data model file, MAV. It is mainly used for network monitoring. So that's usually used for network monitoring, network conf, netconf configuration. That's why we use netconf. We use netconf network configuration because SMP, the AMS run SMP usually used for monitor the device. So we have to introduce a new protocol. We call it network configuration. That is netconf. At the 2002 IB network management workshop, 14 essential requirements for network management were raised. We can see some of them. Easy of use, and clear distinguish between configuration data and status data. It means it have two database, configuration database and status data, We can see error, separate obtaining of configuration data and status data and support for data comparison between device. Support comparison between device. That means that you can check the configuration on different device, and the network level service configuration capability. This means if we use CLI, we configure the device one by one, but if you configure use the network level, this means you configure all the device at one time, not one by one. Okay, it supports for network level configuration transactions. It introduces the transactions. proper internal configuration sequence, mirroring the impact caused by configuration changes. And the next is support configuration backup, support configuration backup and restoration. We just see seven of them. So I think you can see it on RFC, search the RFC because all the information is right in RFC 357, 335. This RFC. Okay, in order to match the requirements, we introduced the netconf. We can see here. First, this is the beginning of netconf, and at 2006, NetConf version 1, version 1 is introduced. And at year 2010, at this year, we released the IFC 6020, young 1.0, defining the method of combining with NetConf. Here we can, I can open the imagine here. So this is IFC 6020, YAN, a data modeling language for the network configuration. So in this IFC, will introduce the data module and the YAN syntax, YAN syntax. Okay, let's continue. Here at about 2017, IFC 8040 introduced RESTConf, RESTConf version 1, RESTConf version 1. Okay, we can see the traditional configuration procedure. If we configure the device, first we enter the system view, and then we enter the interface view. We can change the disk, the interface name and the MTU, the MTU. Here is what we input in the CRI, in CRI. Okay, but for the NetConf, it's just like the CRI. A young file describe device data in another way. We can see here, it used this way. This is, we call it a young file, and it's right based on the young language, based on the young language. The young module uses a module container leaf, this structure. It is three layer structure to describe a device. For example, a young model defines field types and specification for router interface and attribute. Here we can see this is just this young file is just a profile. This is just a profile. We can see here this is a leaf name. The name, the type is string. That means the system name is a string, type is a string. So if you want to configure the device, if you use the name, you configure the name, the value type of the name must be a string. Then next is MTU. MTU. Here is type unit, unit 14. Unit 16, unit 16. It means if you configure the interface, MTU, and the value type must be unit 16, unit 16. So young file is just a template, If you want to configure a device, you must forward this template, because it defines the variable type, string. This is our built-in type in YAN field. You can also define your own variable type. The NetConf client converts the YAN file into NetConf message to configure a device. Okay, so here, this is important, the YAN NetConf client. A client, and that means a PC, for example, a PC is a client, this is a server. Client converts the YAN file into NetConf message. That means it will based on the YAN file, and write XML, message. And before is NetConf format, and then is the SSH, and before it is TCP, TCP, and is IP, IP, and layer two, and layer two. And we can see here, the real config, config message is right in XML, XML format, format is here. Okay, let's continue see the structure of NetConf protocol. NetConf overview, NetConf has three objects, three objects. NetConf client, NetConf client. Here, this is a NetConf, NetConf client, SDN controller, management platform, or just one PC, or just the one PC. And NetConf server, the device work as the server, work as the server. And the NetConf message, it means the message communicate between the client and the server. We see the NetConf protocol framework. NetConf is partitioned into four layers. Four layers. We can see here. And the NetConf message have four layer. Have four layer. At the bottom of the layer is a secure transport layer. It provides a communication path for intersection between the client and the server. Currently, Huawei device use SSH. Use SSH. Yesterday we have just learned SSH, and drop it here. TCP, SSH. Then is secure, secure layer, and the message layer. Message layer provides a simple RPC request and response. It just have three tab, three tab. Message layer, here, message layer, has three tab. This is a request RPC, RPC, just like a request message. RPC this RPC reply, reply. This is a pair. A pair of message. The client send RPC and the server send RPC reply. And the notification is sent by the device, or by the server automatically. It will send some notification, notifications. Okay, the NetConf client use an RPC element to encapsulate the RPC request the information and send the information to the NetConf server. Upon this, upon this update, the NetConf server uses an RPC reply element to encapsulate RPC response information and return the information to the NetConf client. Then the upper layer is the operation layer. Operation layer. Here we can see operation layer defines a group of basic operation as RPC invoking methods. This operation constitute the basic NetConf capabilities, NetConf capabilities. So the client and the server must negotiate the capability. Here, the client and the server must negotiate the operation layer. This the device capability. The payload, is a container layer. The payload is a container layer. Container layer describes configuration data involved in network management. The configuration data depends on vendor's device. Currently, mainstream data modules include the schema module and the YAML module. But now, different vendors may all want to use YAML module. YAML module. So we just focus on the YAML module. YAML module. Okay, here is XML encoding example. Example. NetConf uses text fields to represent complex hierarchical data. Here is an example. And we can see some syntax. Okay. The header of XML encoding is follow. Is follow. So this is the first line. First line, we see the meaning arrow question and indicates the start of an introduction. And question, the right arrow indicates the end of an introduction. You can see here, this is the begin, and this is the end. XML indicates this is the XML file, and the version, this is the XML version, and the encoding is indicated the character size ending format. Only UTF-8 encoding is supported here. The XML document forms a tree structure, unfolding from the root, the node to from heading, a body tag is private. We call this is a tag, different tag. And the note is if we draw a tree here, the note is the root, and it have different tags, different leaf, to from heading, and the body. These four tags are parallel. Okay, the XML is similar to HTML. But the tag in HTML must be is not euro-defined. The XML, you can define any tag. You can define another tag, for example, system name, and write in this way. Content is nested in the tag format, and the slash indicates the end of the current tag. Okay, if you wanted to learn XML encoding, here you'll see you some learning material. I have show you yesterday. And see it again. Okay. This is XML. I open one site here. Okay. If you open this one site, you can see the XML language. XML language. Here is the introduction, and you can learn it. Here is also another open here. Okay, I send this all this material again. Okay, I can't open the this website, but I think you can open it on your local PC. Okay, let's continue. Okay, this is the begin, and with a slash, this is the end of the tag. It's XML encoding. Okay, then we learn the four layer of NetConf. Here is a transport layer and the message layer. NetConf uses SSH to implement secure transmission and use remote procedure calls, RPC, to implement communication between the client and the server. The RPC just like you can see, it's just the request and the reply, because we use the SMP message, SMP. SMP also have the request and reply, just this is the request, this is the reply. The RPC framework is independent of the transport layer and is used to indicate the NetConf request and response. Here for the RPC reply, response message sent by the user server to the RPC. The value of the message ID, the value in the message ID are the same. RPC error is sent in RPC reply. One RPC reply. One RPC reply element can obtain multiple RPC error elements. If OK is sent in RPC reply, no error data is returned. Here we list some operation of NetConf. We just see some of them. We see here a dating data. If we need to configure the device, we use a data config. We can create, modify, or delete configuration data. The operation is a data config. Querying data, we can have two types: get config and get. Get config is query the configuration data, and get query the current configuration and the status data of the device. So get contain get config. Get config is just can query the configuration data. In the backup or recovery scenario, we can use copy config and delete config. So you just see the name. You know its function. The NetConf also support locking and unlocking. Locks and explicitly occupy the permission to modify the configuration data set. This is to avoid the confusion. When two different engineers configure the same device, you can lock. Some model on the device. For example, someone configure OSPF, it just lock this model, and other people can configure BGP. The other people can lock BGP module. Okay. In the transaction scenario, we have a commit means commits configuration data in the candidate data set to the current running configuration data. So I think if you are familiar with the NetEngine serial device, we use the Huawei VRP8. When you configure the device, you may configure in different mode. One is called the candidate database, and the other is the current running database. And last is the session. We can close the NetConf session or kill the NetConf session. Here the NetConf session. They are different. The close is the normal end of the NetConf session. So here, I think you may to learn the operation of NetConf. Learn the operation of NetConf. Later we'll give some example. Operation objects on NetConf. We can see here. Candidate configuration database. This is a candidate database, and this is a running database. This is a startup configuration. For different database, we can use different operations. We can edit config the candidate database and the running config database. If you config the candidate database. You must use the commit, the operation commit, and then the candidate database will become the running database. Okay, you can also lock and unlock the candidate or running database. Here we can also restart or recovery or copy config to the startup database, startup database, and we can also delete the startup database. Usually we not process the startup database. We just focus on the candidate database and the running configuration database. Okay. here is an example delivering VLAN configuration. You can see here, this is that XML. Here is the RPC, RPC layer, and this is the operation layer, edit config, operation layer, edit config, target. We can see here we want to configure the running database here, running database. This means it will configure the configuration is immediately take effect effect. And from here, we can see it's the payload. That means the content layer. Here is the content layer. And here is the operation layer. For the content layer, we configure interface merge. We can see. The operation is merge. Other operation are as follows: see, create, delete, remove, or merge. So the merge is in the database, modify the existing data or create data that doesn't exist. It means it doesn't exist VLAN 10. VLAN 10 it will create. It will already exist VLAN 10. It will modify the VLAN 10, modify the VLAN 10. Okay, this is the operation layer and the content layer. And content layer here, the netconf container layer config data for device, configuration data requires a modeling language, which depends on the implementation of each vendor. Netconf 1 has no requirements on the model language. Netconf 1.1 clearly defines the combination with YARN and start to standardize the Netconf container format. So currently, Huawei device supports the following content layers: Huawei YARN, Netconf Schema, IETF YARN, and OpenConfig YARN. They are written in different format. Okay, schema is a set of defined rules for describing XML documents. The schema is written in XML format. That's the bigger difference between schema and YARN. We can see here is an example. We use YARN language. To configure the device, I think you must remember the message sent to the server, sent to the device, all is written in XML, XML format. We configure the VLAN 10, And this XML namespace, here is just a pass. That means that you are use the Huawei VLAN YARN, Huawei VLAN YARN file, because on one device you may have many different YARN files for different protocol. OSPF you have a YARN file, BGP you have a YARN file, and the VLAN you have a YARN file. Okay. Config container layer information. Namespace is a container layer is this is a Huawei LAN. You can also see the namespace requirements in RFC. We also give a configuration user schema. Here it is. But today, we recommend you use Huawei Yang. Okay. Here is the netconf configuration on the server. On the device. We can see some of them. Okay, netconf run the netconf command in the system view to enter, and this is the number we enable the S netconf server server enable. Okay. Then we introduce some basic concept of Yang. Our netconf protocol is standardized. Data content, the container layer is not standardized. How can we describe a piece of data? A data model is abstraction and expression of data features. And the master defines the data structure and the data integrated constraint and the data operation. So this is the requirements of the data module. Yang, it should for yet another next generation is a data module language. It just give you a template of profile. The Yang model defines the hierarchical structure. And it can be used for netconf based operations. Modeling objects include the configuration, status, the model procedure calls, and the notification. Now this allows a complete description of all data exchanged between a netconf client and the server. So Yang has these features. It has a tree-like structure, just like this tree-like structure. Container leaf, and so on. So data modules are presented as modules and sub-modules, and it can be converted to the Yang independent notation module based on the XML syntax without any loss. That means you can, if you write the Yang file in XML format, then the Yang file is called in. Define the built-in data types and extensible types. Here is the introduction to Yang file. This is a module. A Yang file can be defined as a module or sub-module. Modules and sub-module can reference other modules, model field to use the data types and the structure defined in other modules. We can see Yang version, and Yang namespace, and organization information, contact, file description, change history. This is a model example C term. Okay, we see the cell in Yang language. We call it leaf node. Our leaf node is used to define a variable of a simple specified type and is declared using the leaf keyword. The leaf is smallest cell of in Yang language. Here we give you an example. We configure a leaf. The leaf name is host name. The type is string. string, and here description, what's the name for this system? That means if you want to config the host name, you must write XML message based on the file. Here, this is the tag, host name, begin and end. And this is the host name, my.example.kim. Here may be Huawei. R1, system name. It's just the requirements, the type is string. You can also with the other number, 123, here. You can configure the device name, this is a message sent to the device. And then is a leaf list. In this leaf list is used to define an array variable and is declared using leaf list keyword. Use leaf list. You can configure many same format. Leaf list. Type string describing list of domain name to search. Now we give, because it's a leaf list, we can input a different string here. Okay, then it's a list node. The list node contains some leaf. Our list node is used to define a higher level data node. Each list node is uniquely identified by a key and can contain multiple leaf node. The list contain leaf. All leaf list. List. You can see here key name, and this is a leaf name, leaf file name, and the leaf class. This is example. User is root tag user, and the name a name, leaf name. Name is a string, and the file name is also a string. Here you can input any string, and the class is also the type is string. So you can input any string here. The app leaf list, and the upper is a container system. The container can contain other containers. So container nodes are used to define data sets in a large scope. The scope is more larger than a list. Each container node has only different sub node code, but doesn't have any value. These sub nodes can be container, leaf list, or list node. We can see other grouping target, leaf address, a type IP address. This type is user defined. Grouping is used to define nodes that can be reused. Generally, grouping is used together with use. In this example, a target defines leaf address and port. This tag target. The name is target. It define IP address and port number. If use target is specified in the container peer, the leaf model is reused. This is another container. And the container description, we use target. That means this, because we create the label target using keyword grouping. It means it can be reused. It can be reused. So in the container peer, we use this special tag target, and with the keyword use. Okay, config true and config false. Config true and config false is used to distinguish configuration data from status data. Config false indicates status data, config true indicates the configuration data. And here is the data type. Built in. Young language, built in language, binary, bits, brain, importing, int 8, int 32, and so on. The young model supports built in default data types, and the type define, you can use this keyword, type define, and this is the name you want to define, the name. Here, percent, and type unit 8, range from 0 to 100%. This is the number range, this is the user defined type. So you can create a leaf node, and use the type you just create, just define. You define yourself, So here's you, how do I load a young profile? A young file is loaded on netconf client, such as NMS or SDN controller. That means the young file is storage both the client and the server. This is the device client. Device is the server, and this is the client. The same young file, is stored both device and the client, and the client. So sometimes you can download, from the device. You can download the young file from the device. Also, you can download the young file from the client, from the client to device. Okay. At last, we introduce the RESTconf protocol. Why we introduce RESTconf? This is because the RESTconf is also based on the young module, we just configure it use the web. Okay. Now we see the origin of RESTconf. RESTconf is a doctoral series of Roy Thomas building in 2000, architectural style and the design of network-based software architecture. REST is a representational data transfer. URI, and representation mode, and status transfer use HTTP, operation. REST client and server, we use client and server interaction framework, you can also say REST in RFC, here I can open one for you. This number 3986. They introduce the URI and from a reference you can search error RFC. Okay, the HTTP have this action, get, post, put, and delete. But netconf, we have this. This is what NetConf operation NetConf operation. I think you must distinguish it. The restConf have this operation, get, post, put, delete. You can say restConf allow web applications to access configuration data, status data, and event notification of network device in a modular and scalable manner. It has the following features. The restConf use HTTP method to perform operation, CRUD on data, defined by YAML. YAML file can be shared by NetConf and restConf. It means if you have a YAML file on the device, and you have a YAML file on your OMPC, you have two ways to configure the device. Both restConf and NetConf, the data encoding format can be just for the restConf, the encoding format can be XML or JSON. For Huawei, we just use XML. Compared with NetConf, restConf use different operation methods and the data encoding format. It means you just install a web application, Here is a comparison between restConf and NetConf. HTTP, TLS over TCP, TCP. It's just compare the two layer of NetConf. And for the operation layer, we have get, post, put, patch, and delete. For the container layer, NetConf just have one format, XML. For the restConf, we have two types, XML and JSON. Okay. NetConf operates multiple configuration, libraries of our device. The transaction mechanism and the rollback mechanism are available. This is a big difference. The transaction mechanism and the rollback mechanism are available. But for restConf, restConf use HTTP, which are stateless, have no transaction mechanism and don't support rollback. RestConf don't support rollback. Okay, we can see the operation. Operation comparison. RestConf get get HTTP get just as the function in NetConf. Get config and get post post edit config or invoke an RPC operation. Put put here edit config. Create or replace. Copy config. Put on database and delete. This is also easy to understand. Okay, we see here is a typical restConf interaction. A complete restConf interaction include a request and a response. So in this example, the client uses the operation method to obtain the operation submitted by device. The device is born. This one supports following operation, post delete, restConf. We can see here option when we send a restConf request message and the response in HTTP format, HTTP 200, okay. This is the negotiating for the operation, We support post delete, get, head, patch, and options. Here is a request format method and the URI HTTP version header value and the request body. We'll introduce HTTP in other slide. You can also learn HTTP by yourself. Here is a request example. The IP address of restConf request object is this IP address. Change the value domain name to ABC and the value access list to 10. we use the operation post, operation post. And this is just the container list leaf, just write in this way. This is a pass, this is a pass. A host, that means the destination, the server device, container type, container type. You can also search container type, domain, XML namespace, the domain name, change it to ABC, and the access limit, name to 10. This is the requested body, requested body. We see here is a REST conf response. Here, just this is the HTTP. HTTP response message. Response message. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. File part. HTTP version. Status code. Message. And value and response body. Here, we list the HTTP status code. Status code. 1xx. Describing 100 continue. And the 2. Usually we see the 200 okay. That means the success, the reading body is available, success. If you see the HTTP error, 404, not found, not found. The requested resource can't be found, can't be found. And I think you also see the 403, this means access denied, access denied. Now here is a REST conf response example container type and the container length in the header describe body information. The body type is XML. This is the type is XML and the container length is 0. So here is the introduction of REST conf. Then let's have a break for 10 minutes. Then we'll do the NetConf experiment. Then we will show the NetConf experiment. Okay, let's have a break for 10 minutes. I don't know how to make this one.